Church is Sunday evening. Hey, I'm live and on the air. Dark Blue Hymnal. We're going to begin by singing in the Dark Blue Hymnal tonight. But before we do, I'm going to ask Brother Tim if you'll stand up and in a nice loud voice ask God to bless tonight's services, sir. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Song number 531 in the Dark Blue Hymnals. 531 is All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name. Cross. That old was a wondrous attraction for me. For the dear Lamb of God left his glory above to bear it to dark Calvary. So family here tonight. We love you guys. Song number 271, and you know, in a song or two, I may ask for a couple of testimonies. If you have a testimony, somebody has a word of testimony, God's just been so good to you, and you realize it, and you need and want to share it with us, that would be wonderful. So let's sing In the Garden, In the Garden.
Come to the garden. With me. birds hush their singing, and the melody that he gave to me within my heart is ringing, and he walks with me and he talks with me and he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there none other has ever. But he bids me go through the voice of woe. His voice to me is calling, and he walks with me and he talks with me. And he tells me I am his own, and the joy we share as we tarry there none other has ever known.
Now, the lily of the valley, and then we're going to take some testimonies. I pray that you've got something that you're thinking of sharing with us. The lily of the valley.
I have found a friend in Jesus. He's everything to me. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. The lily of the valley, in him alone I see all I need to cleanse and make me fully whole. In sorrow he's my comfort, in trouble he's my stay. He tells me every care on him to roll. He's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
Now, I know we're a Baptist church, but it's okay to clap your hands. But the problem is we're a Baptist church. And I don't know how our good timing is, you know what I'm saying? But we'll get it, okay? Second verse, here we go.
He all my griefs has taken and all my sorrows borne. In temptation, he's my strong and mighty tower. I have all for him forsaken, and all my idols torn from my heart, and now he keeps me by his power. Though all the world forsake me, and Satan tempt me sore, through Jesus I shall safely reach the goal. He's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. He will never, never leave me, nor yet forsake me here, while I live by faith and do his blessed will. A wall of fire about me, I've nothing now to fear. With his manna he my hungry soul shall fill. Then sweeping up to glory to see his blessed face, where rivers of delight shall ever roll. He's a lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the fairest of 10,000 to my soul.
We have one more song to sing, but I wanted to see if anybody had a word of testimony. I just would like to say that I'm very thankful for Andrea playing the piano for us. That's so great. That's so great. And Alice, when she's here, she's able to teach, and she's teaching some of the young people to play. And so she gave up on me a long time ago, George. I got in an argument with the teacher, and she quit. So at any rate, but word of testimony. Anybody have a word of testimony? Yes, Tim. Amen. No. No. Amen. 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 Yes. I hear you. I know. Praise the Lord. Amen. Thank you. And we love having you here. Amen. You know, I talk about this in Romans 15:4. He gives us all these examples so that we could have encouragement and peace and hope. And then he's got so many examples around us. Even living in this day and age where you see, well, they've gone through it. It's a tough road, but they've gone through it. They've gone through it. They've gone through it. How'd they get through it? It was the Lord. It was the Lord. Amen. Thank you for the testimony. Somebody else? Brother Rick. Oh, wow. He did. Amen.
So it's just neat the way that God works. That He's sovereign.
Yes.
Romans 8:28-29
are true. Yes, they are.
Amen. So thankful we're all saved.
Amen. Amen. You know, I was telling the folks this morning, if you've seen pictures of the car, you go, how did they? It was the hand of God. Hand of God, and we praise Him for it, and we give Him full credit for it. Amen. Amen. Do the next thing. Yes. Don't get frustrated by it. Absolutely. Great peace have they that love thy law. Somebody else have a word of testimony. This site has already had two. How about over here? Anybody over here have a word of testimony? Go ahead.
I don't know. So we had a litter of puppies. There was only two puppies. And as soon as we gave them their second vaccine, we took them out. And a couple or a family passed by and they bought the boy and the other one that we had. A couple weeks later, while I'm passing out tracts, everyone at work, and I'm working with the girl that came and bought the puppy. Uh-huh. Like 300,000 people here in Bakersfield. So, four floors in that animal
Wow. Yeah. So God's giving you a connection there.
I don't know either,
but you know, God is not a God of coincidence. We think in that those terms. Well, you will say, well, what a coincidence. No. No, he's a God of order and plan. So just know that God's working in your life and sees that moment that he gives you. That's good. Good, George. Somebody else have a word of testimony. I don't want to leave anybody out. I love hearing testimonies. One of the churches I used to lead the music in, I'd call on people just to, hey, give us a testimony. I didn't really care for that too much. But anyway, well, let's go ahead and sing this last song. Stand with me, if you will. It's Victory in Jesus. And there's a place in there that we sing, that we shout out, praise God, okay? I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, of his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. Praise God! He loved me and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of its cleansing power. Broken spirit, and somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is due him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story, and some sweet day Savior forever. may be seated. We're going to have a children's class tonight. We're going to be dealing with some things that are a little bit sensitive. So if you want your child to go with Christina, she's going to have a class over there. That'd be just fine. And cool. I just love to see the children run off, big smiles on their faces, going to class. That's great. That's great. Just want to mention a couple things. Don't normally take time to do this this time of the service, but we've got prayer meetings that's going on Wednesday night, back here at Delaney Hall at 6 p.m. 6 p.m. at Delaney Hall. Please come out and be a part of that. Be a part of that. We need to be a praying church. Amen? And keep that in mind. Also coming up on the 16th, the 14th and 15th will be the Master's Men. On the 16th, Brother McCracken will be here with us all day. That's going to be a great day. Please plan on trying to bring somebody with you. Bring a neighbor. Bring a relative. Bring somebody that doesn't go to church anywhere. Amen? That needs to go to church. And then on the 27th, we're going to have Brother Stephen Benefield here, missionary to Cambodia, is going to be with us on Sunday night. Well, where are we at on our Sunday evening services? What book of the Bible have we been in? First Corinthians. What have we been talking about? The carnal church. Tonight we'll be in chapter 6. Last week we studied about the malady. The malady is a disease or it's an ailment in the church, and it had to do with the son with the father's wife, and they had to deal with it. And we talked about how that churches need to deal with situations as they rise God's way. What happens? What do? You go Matthew 18 is our template. You go to someone 101, there's an issue. And then if that's not received, then you come back with two or three, and you deal with it. And if it's still not received, then take it before the church, and you deal with it that way. The church at Corinth, they were very prideful. And we learned last week that they were very comfortable with this man's sin for whatever reason. But it probably was because they are so carnal. Now, can you be carnal and be a Christian? Absolutely. Lot would probably have been a good example of carnality. But very comfortable with this man's sin. They had their own code of morality. I wouldn't do that, but that's okay for you. That's what was going on in church. I wouldn't do that, but that's okay for you. But I do this, and that's okay for me. But they didn't have God's code of morality. And that's what we need to be about. Tonight we're going to talk about the two other maladies. Keep in mind, who had invaded whom? The city had invaded the church. That's why you had all this teaching going on. The Corinthian way of doing things. And the church had been invaded by the city. It should be just the opposite. The city needs to invade the church. The church was had a very casual view of sin. So we're going into the second malady. Let's have a word of prayer, asking God to help us tonight as we get into His Word. And folks, let's try to make application in our own life. Allow God's Word to speak to your heart. Allow God's Word to fashion you and form you to what He wants you to be. Father, I pray that at this time, You'd have full control of my lips. God, sometimes I just kind of go off on a little bit of a tangent, and I pray that I'd stay on topic. God, may I say the words You'd have me to say. May I not make more light of something than I should, but God, may I make the point of what Your Word is saying. God, I ask that You would grow McKee Road Baptist Church for Your use, for Your purposes. God, we had asked that we'd see souls saved here. We'd see the baptismal waters stirred. Dear God, we want so badly to see You doing miracles here. May we be a part of that. God, have Your will and way, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, the second malady is litigation between believers. Litigation between believers. They were suing one another. Now, let's go ahead and read. Let's go ahead and read 1 Corinthians chapter 6. We'll just read verse 1 right here. Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unjust and not before the saints? And not before the saints? They were a sue happy people. A sue happy people. Not that they were named Sue, but they were a sue happy people. You know, that's why we have so much paperwork today. If you go somewhere to do something, a lot of times, well, you need to sign this. What's this? This is a waiver in case you break your neck or something, you're not going to sue us. We're trying to get our house around that we can try to put it on the market to sell. And with COVID-19, we had like 20-some pages to sign an initial, sign an initial. Alice said, what was all that? I said, I don't know. So we just got her done, you know. But it had to do with COVID-19. But how should children of God resolve legal disputes? We live, like I said, in such a world where everyone's suing one another. And it was true in the Corinthians church as well. It was true in the Corinthians church. When you have a dispute with someone, sometimes it would be a situation where you might have to go to court. However, I don't want to get ahead of myself, but the other day I walked out to my mailbox and it was a thing from the highway patrol. And I thought, what have I done? What have I done? And I was reading on that and somebody had come, and it's the second time it's happened. They went through about 50 feet of my fence. They crashed. They decided they wanted to take a shortcut. And so they went through the fence. So I'm going to have to go down and get a hold of the people and talk to them about fixing it and getting it taken care of. But we talked about the way that we should do it. Matthew 18, go one-on-one, then with a fellow brother, and then before the church. Paul is, what he's doing here is he's correcting the carnality. Paul is correcting the carnality. And he's constructing their spirituality. Correcting the carnality, and he's constructing, building on the spirituality in this practice of litigation. You know, right now, we are in a day and age where there are several high media, trials that are going on, right? A lot of trials. I heard a congressperson say on the radio today that, if it doesn't go our way, we're just going to go out and protest. We're going to go out and protest. Well, protesting is fine if that's all you're going to do. But somehow we need to learn to accept the verdict when it comes up. Sometimes legal issue comes up between believers. You know what we should do if we cannot settle it within ourselves? Dare any of you, having a matter against another, go to law before the unjust and not before the saints. And not before the saints. What's it saying? You got a problem you can't solve? Take it before the church. Take it before the church. And a lot of people might say, well, I just don't want everybody in my business. I have a friend of mine, Brother Larry Davis, the one that is waiting on a liver transplant, his wife. Her name is Gwendolyn. We call her Pokey. But she had shared some things on Facebook. And then I was talking to him on the phone. And Larry said, I just don't like everybody in my business. You know, sometimes we don't like everybody in our business. But if there's an issue that cannot be solved, before going to court, the Bible says we should take it before the church. You know, somewhere along the line, church has lost the prominence that it once held. Church is a very important place to be. It's not just a place for us to come and sit down and sing a couple of songs and say, I've gone to church. But we're part of this body that God has put together. And we're not allowing it to do all the things it should be doing. If we've got an issue, folks, you've got an issue one with another. Somebody over here has an issue with somebody over here or vice versa. And you can't get it settled. Don't go to court. Bring it for the men. Bring it for the church. And let's deal with it. And Paul was actually saying, how dare you? How dare you take it outside the church to the lost, to have them settle the matter? Settle this in-house. settle this in house. Here's a thought. It's better in matters of small consequence. Sometimes we make an issue a lot bigger than it is. Sometimes it's better just to go, you know what? That's all right. No problem. You don't have a problem with me. I don't have a problem. You don't think you should owe me this. That's good. That's not going to come between you and me, my brother. Be the better man. Be the better man. Verse 2 and following says, Do you not know that the saints shall judge the world? And if the world shall be judged by you, are ye unworthy to judge the smallest matters? Know ye not that we shall judge angels? How much more things that pertain to this life? If then ye have judgments of things pertaining to this life, set to them to judge who are least esteemed in the church, I speak to your shame. Is it so that there is not a wise man among you? I mean, really. Of all places, you should find a wise man. Not wise in his own wisdom, but wise in the ways of God, would be in God's house, in the body of Christ. No, not one that shall be able to judge between his brethren. But brother goeth to law with brother. And that before the unbelievers. He said, this shouldn't be. This is what's going on. Now, therefore, there is utterly a fault among you because ye go to law one with another. Why do ye not rather take wrong? Why do ye not rather suffer yourselves to be defrauded? Nay, ye do wrong and defraud, and that your brethren. Know ye not that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God? Be not deceived, neither fornicators, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor effeminate, nor abusers of themselves with mankind, nor thieves, nor covetous, nor drunkards, nor revilers, nor extortioners shall inherit the kingdom of God. And such were some of you, but ye are washed, but ye are sanctified, but ye are justified in the name of the Lord Jesus and by the Spirit of our God, our God. So that was the malady that they were dealing with. If you have an issue, the Bible is saying, and it falls within the body here, the brother and sister in Christ, and you can't work it out, then bring it for the church. Allow somebody within the body to help litigate what's going on. Let's not take our laundry outside and have it go to some lost individual to deal with it. The third malady was Paul's judgment on children of God frequenting prostitutes. In the city of Corinth, prostitution was an integral part of the pagan religion. Hard to believe, but it was. Their temple to Aphrodite was a prominent place where people went. And the subject continued to be immoral behavior. Immoral behavior. See, the city and its ways had invaded the church, and they continued to practice that. You think, how could somebody do that? And yet, I think people could look at us and say, well, how could you do that? Or how could you do that? In the Greco-Roman idol-worshiping culture of Paul's day, sex of all kinds have been normalized for nearly everyone. Everybody's doing it. Everybody's doing it. Oh, I don't do that, but that's okay for you. I do this. That included prostitution. That included adultery, pedophilia, homosexuality, and so on. All those things that we go, ooh. And yet, it was common practice. You know, you grow up in that environment, it's not hard to understand how some of those in the church that perhaps got saved but then were not grounded in the faith would just continue on in those ways. It was what you did. Paul is showing in this chapter why avoiding sexual immorality is so essential for believers. Any sin will drag you down, but sexual immorality especially. Verse 12, all things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. All things are lawful for me, but I will not be brought under the power of any. Meats for the belly and belly for the meats, but God shall destroy both it and them. Now the body is not for fornication. You get that? The body is not for fornication. A couple of weeks ago, well, maybe longer than that, we talked about fornication. And he went through quite a list of things, what fornication is. The Bible says fornication. The body is not for fornication. We don't have that right. But for the Lord, and the Lord for the body. A child of God should consider what is fit for him to do, not something he can do because it is lawful. We can't hide behind the law of the land and say, I can do this because the law gives me that right, when it goes against God's law. Okay? Okay? God's law supersedes man's laws. You know, where the laws and the executive mandates are handed down, you can't go to church. Well, excuse me, that wasn't your right. God gave us the right. Jesus said, all power is given unto me in heaven and earth. And so we follow his authority. Where it falls out of line with God's word, we obey it. You know, I might have the right to eat that food, but not to the point where you become a glutton. All things are lawful unto me, but all things are not expedient. God has a noble purpose, you see, and a destiny for our body. It's part of who we are. The Greeks looked at the body as a prison, as a prison. A real man couldn't get out of there. And that's where the real person lived, inside. But Christ views our bodies as a real part of us. It's all a part of us. We have the material and the immaterial parts. We should never downplay what we do with our bodies. Never downplay. 1 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 20 now says, for ye are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. Not just your spirit, but glorify God in your body. That's how we do with our body, what we do with our body. You know, this attraction for the opposite sex is real strong, or the attraction for sex can get a hold of a person and just control you to the point where you can't control yourself. But we're bought with a price. Consider the price that it costs God. And it's because of that we are to glorify God in our body. 1 Corinthians chapter 7, 23 says, ye are bought with a price. Be not ye the servants of men. Be not ye the servants of men. In verse 14 of our chapter it says, and God hath both raised up the Lord and will also raise up us by his own power. There's a future destiny for our body. There's a future destiny for our body. Verse 15 says, know ye not that your bodies are the members of Christ? Shall I then take the members of Christ and make them the members of an harlot? God forbid. God forbid. See, Christ has a claim on our bodies, not just our spirit, but our body. This is the temple of God. Lives within me. Wherever you go, you take him with you. Whatever you do, you take him with you. Verse 16 says this, what know ye not, which is joined to an harlot is one body? For two, saith he, shall be one flesh. Shall be one flesh. You're getting into areas where you start using this body for things that are not intended. The Bible talks about marriage and how the bed is undefiled. But folks, sex was intended for marriage. For marriage. It's not intended for the single. In this world, they say, oh, you got to be kidding me. No, I'm not kidding you. That's why you marry. That's why you marry. You're getting into an area that you have no business being in. I remember years ago, I was probably 14, maybe 15. Had a good friend of mine, Dave Sanders. I don't know if you remember Dave Sanders, that name. Played the guitar. He's very good at it. Rick, he was a very good guitarist. And he knew my dad played music. And he looked at me and he says, "Hey, I'd like to borrow your dad's guitar." "Oh, that should be fine," I said. "You know, yeah, sure, you can do that. No problem." So that was on a Sunday morning. So I went home and I happened to mention to Dad. And my dad was, "Dad would do anything for you." And I said, "Dad, Dave's going to come over and borrow your guitar." And he looked at me and he says, "You call him back and you tell him no." I had taken a liberty that wasn't mine. When you go into a sexual situation with someone other than your spouse, you're getting in an area that you do not belong in. You do not belong in it. One soma means one flesh. One flesh. And that's what it said in that verse. Let's read it again. It says, "What, know ye not that he which is joined to an harlot is one body?" You're starting to do things that causes a one flesh situation that was meant for just the husband and the wife. The husband and the wife. One flesh relationship is set up when people have a relationship sexually. Sexual relationship. It doesn't constitute a marriage bond, but it does constitute a bond. It does constitute a bond. You know, we got something going on. We got something going on. Huh. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 17. "But he that is joined unto the Lord is one spirit." This is a deeper unity. But the point is that we've already united in a spiritual relationship with the Lord. To have sex with an unapproved partner is devastating to your relationship. Devastating to your relationship. Take your Bibles and turn back to the book of Genesis. Book of Genesis, chapter 39. Genesis chapter 39, verse 7. Story of Joseph, a godly man. Oh, you know, whenever I get a job or would take a new job, and when Alice was working, what we would pray is, "God, make us a Joseph. Make us a Joseph so that everything we touch, because of you, will be blessed. We'll be blessed. And let your name be proclaimed and let you be honored and glory and magnified and glorified." In verse 7 here, Joseph says, "And it came to pass after these things that his master's wife cast her eyes upon Joseph." Now, there you've got a situation here that usually it's the guys. But you know what? I think the ladies too, obviously. "Cast her eyes upon Joseph." She shouldn't have been doing that. But men and women, when they're out and about, we shouldn't be doing that either. We shouldn't be doing that. "I've made a covenant with my eyes that I might not look upon a maid." It says, "Cast her eyes upon Joseph," and she said, "Lie with me. Lie with me." Now, if you don't have a walk with the Lord, that could tempt you. That could tempt you. Verse 8, "But he refused." Good for Joseph. "And said unto his master's wife, Behold, my master wotteth not what is with me in the house, and he hath committed all that he hath to my hand. There's none greater in this house than I, neither hath he kept back anything from me but thee, because thou art his wife." How, and he's got it. See, he's got it figured out. Look at this answer. He said, "How then can I do this great wickedness and sin against God?" You know, in our flesh gets stirred up. We get stirred up. And we go, "Oh, opportunity. Oh, I can do this. I can do this." He said, "No, I'm not going to do it because it's a sin against God." "And it came to pass as she spake to Joseph day by day. Oh, she was persistent. She didn't give up. She kept after him. She kept after him. You got to have a walk with the Lord, guys. Ladies, you got to have a walk with the Lord that when this time of temptation comes, you stand. You stand in him. Day by day, that he hearkened not unto her to lie by her or to be with her. And it came to pass about this time that Joseph went into the house to do his business, and there was none of the men of the house there within. And I can imagine she must have been hiding around the corner or something. It says, and she caught him by his garment, saying, now she's got a hold of him, saying, lie with me. And he left his garment in her hand and fled and got him out. Joseph was determined that he would not sin against God. You say, how can I deal with these situations when they come up in my life? Run. Run. My dad used to tell me, us boys, he said, nothing wrong with avoiding a fight. If you need to run away, run away. You know, if you can avoid a fight, avoid a fight. If you're ever cornered, he said, if you're ever cornered in a room, grab a chair and start swinging, because there's no such thing as a fair fight. But run. When this comes up, run. He tells them to flee from sexual immorality. Run like you're escaping something that might harm you. Job was a man perfect in God's eye, wanted to shoot evil. He ran from it, went the other way. Because in this situation, sexual immorality will destroy you. It will destroy you. I've seen it destroy a lot of good men. What a shame. What a shame that we give in to our lusts. We need to have a walk with God like Joseph did and stand in his strength. Even if the culture around you makes fun of you for it. Oh, you got to be kidding me. You got to be kidding me. Your wife, she'll never know. Yeah, right. Verses 18 and 19. This is what it says. It says, flee fornication. Flee fornication. I mean, it's a two-word sentence. This is one of Paul's briefest sentences. Flee fornication. He said everything he needed to say in those two words. Run from it. Men and women, run from it. Run from it. It'll destroy you. You know, we start off in our sin, whatever it is, thinking that, oh, this is something I enjoy. This is something that makes me happy. Before you know it, it has such a grasp on you. And you will be miserable. You will be miserable. Flee fornication. Every sin that a man doeth is without the body. But he that committeth fornication sinneth against his own body. There's something different about fornication. Something different about fornication. And how that it's a sin against your own body. Paul shows that sexual immorality is different than from other kinds of sin. Because, you know, it's a form of self-harm. I was out with my son, Matthew. This is probably 4 or 5 years ago. And so I'm doing a ride-along. And Matt had said, now, Dad, when you go out, he said, you're going to be my lieutenant. I said, okay. So we go to this one house. He gets a call, and he says, Dad, he says, we're going to go in this house. And he says, I've been here before. This gentleman has trouble. He has some problems. And he said, he called him by his name. And he was dealing with it. And he said, would you lift up your shirt and show my lieutenant? And when he did, he was just scarred. He cut himself. Self-mutilation. Fornication is a form of self-mutilation. We might commit other sins with our bodies, but sexual immorality unites us sinfully with another person. And it happens on a deeply physical and a deeply spiritual level. One soma, one flesh. intended to be for the husband and wife. And yet we go off into an area, and now we've made it convoluted. 1 Corinthians chapter 6, 19. What? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God? And look at that last phrase. And ye are not your own. And ye are not your own. Alice and I got married. It's one of those things you just learn more and more as you go along. I'm hers. I'm hers. She's mine. Not our own. With Christ, we're his. We're his. To do with whatsoever he will. Whatsoever he will. You know, it's interesting that Paul would say this to the Corinthians who were carnal Christians. There's no question. There's no question that they had the Holy Spirit within them. But that said, even today, there are Christians that go to prostitutes. There are Christians that may dabble in homosexuality. How can they do that? You know what? It's the sin that impacts them. We've all got our own sin that impacts us. 1 Corinthians 6:20 says, "For ye are bought with a price. Therefore glorify God in your body." Folks, we need to focus on glorifying God with our body. Glorify God where we take our body, what we put into our body, how we maintain our body, and who you share your body with. That's the whole point. And in your spirit, which are God's. Let's pray. Father, I thank you for the book of 1 Corinthians. I thank you for these lessons on carnality. And God, you're teaching us not to be carnal, but to build upon the spirituality. Father, I pray that as a body here of believers, that we would learn not to dabble or have anything to do with fornication. Shouldn't be a part of our life. Shouldn't be a part of our walk. God, we need to realize that you bought us and paid a price for us. God, we need to understand that our body is the temple of the Holy Ghost and that we're not our own. God, may we leave here tonight desiring to be a Joseph and say, when presented with an opportunity to sin, how can I do this great wickedness and sin against thee? Have your will and way, I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to take